our Telecommunications Advisory Commission. First order of business is roll call.
Maren Anderson.
Present.
Bruce Browning.
Present.
Dale Hartman.
Here.
Cindy Hoffman.
Here.
Rolf Peterson.
Here.
Andrew Reinhardt and Toby Keeler. And Toby, we were going to try to have him call in today, and we had some technical problems. So since we have a quorum, we're going to proceed without him. And he says hello to everyone. And sorry about the technical problems, Toby. We'll fix that for the next time you may have to call in.
All right. Thank you. The next item is approval of the minutes. We have the minutes from the December 9th meeting. Are there any corrections, omissions, concerns?
I would make a motion that we approve the minutes as they are. They look pretty good to me from what I saw.
Motion, is there a second?
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Oh, aye. Oh. Aye.
Okay. Because Toby's not here. Because Toby's
gotcha.
Not.
Okay, we can do a voice vote then. Okay, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? All right, that motion carries. Next item is adoption of the agenda, and tonight's agenda is the call to order, the roll call, the approval of minutes, which we just did, and we have public comment. Six is reports and discussions. First item on that is Park TV marketing, publicity, and program report. The second item is cable TV technology presentation, including a fiber optic technology. C is brainstorm future topics for commission action. Based on the discussion at the council study session on Monday, February 22nd. Then we will go to the Comcast HD enhancement and set-top box exchanges. And finally, under reports and discussion will be complaint logs. Then we'll have communications from the chair, commissioners, and city staff, and then adjournment. Is there a motion for approval of the agenda?
I make a motion that we approve the agenda.
All right. And a second. Any further discussion, additions? All right. All in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? That motion carries. So, public comment. I see nobody here for a public comment, but we'll give it a few seconds in case somebody comes in. All right. I think that's it. So, on to reports and discussions. First item is Park TV marketing, publicity, and program report.
Mr. Chair and Commissioners, we did have a short memo in there that summarized the programming from last year for the Park TV channels, which are 14, 15, 16, 17, and 96, all on the Comcast cable system, which is the traditional delivery method that we use. And also, we have a YouTube channel where we have programming from all those different sources that are played on the YouTube channel. So we did do some reporting here and to show that, for example, Channel 14, it's the educational access channel. It included last year approximately 42% of its programs were sports, 31% were performances like concerts or musical performances, and 15% were meetings. The number of program shows and hours actually was increased somewhat in 2015 over 2014. For Channel 15, which is the channel that John McHugh programs, I know that he's reported to you already that he produced over 100 shows. Scott and John staff produced over 100 programs for that channel, but the total for 2015 was 40 shows less. It was 404 shows showed on that channel in 2014, 363 in 2015. So that shows that some of the programming from outside, there was a few fewer programs in that category. And that channel plays back performances 43% and presentations 33%. And so if you want to see performances, that's a great place to look for them. Channel 16 is the on-location channel, and that's what we consider to be the van channel in the sense that the majority of the programming on that channel is sports, 75%, and then the vast majority of the remainder is performances. And so that is a very busy part of the office with over 130 shows in 2015. And Channel 17 is what's playing back this program. That's the Civic Channel. And that's 75% meetings and 13% presentations. So as you can see, if you look at these different local channels, there's different content on each one of them. And then finally, Channel 96, which is the second community TV channel, 82% performances. And we've got a number of staff that work for Park TV, and Jackie here is our supervisor. We had a year-long internship program with Mary Schreier, who participated and was their most recent anchor for Life in the Park, who has gone on to another job, so we'll be looking to replace her. And we also had internships assist with other programming that was seen on each of the channels, primarily short features or public service announcements. So that handles kind of the report of what Park TV does. And the next step is to talk a little bit about marketing for the channels. And I have to admit, I did not draw in any additional information, really, but we do have both John and Jackie here who might be able to throw a little bit of additional comments in here about what Park TV marketing might be up to.
Can I jump in before you do? As I was looking at these, Reg, I noticed virtually across the board, 14, there's like a 22% increase in programming. 15 was the only one that had a drop off. There's 23, almost 24% increase in 16, 30% in 17, and 25% in Channel 96. That's pretty doggone good, I think. So considering the amount of people we have doing all of this and the number of programs that are being produced, it's pretty phenomenal as far as I'm concerned. You guys ought to get a big pat on the back. Thanks.
Well, just a couple things that we're working on. We just completed a new Park TV program brochure. Maybe I'm not talking close enough to it. We just completed a new brochure for Park TV that Misty Lewis, who's mentioned in here as our graphic designer, is finishing up and I think is just looking for final staff comments. So we'll be putting that out on the website and doing some printed copies to hand out at various events. We've also just put out an ad to hire a new production assistant part-time to help Paul Broden on his channel, but who could also help in other areas with John and Scott and Reg producing more packages and programming. We're looking for just one of those people at this point, but may hire as many as two. Those are both part-time, would be part-time up to 20 hours a week. So, and that's in an effort to first ensure that Paul has full staffing for some of the sports, such as baseball, that requires more staff than other sports. But again, we want to see some more support for Scott and John as well. Those are the two of the things I can think of. What do you want to say, John?
At some point this spring, we'll be premiering our delightfully new Park TV golf shirts, which will replace the ones that are that were new, some time ago, but have worn well. And we hope that the commissioners can come to our producer, programmer, volunteer appreciation event, and then leave with a bumper sticker that says Park TV on it, and. There may be some other things. I have a proposal that I didn't finish writing for Jackie to look at. In years past, we've had the mayor proclaim Community TV Month. The first time it coincided with Arnie Carlson proclaiming it. We thought, well, that's great. Let's us do it too. So every 2 years, 1 month out of 24, maybe we can do that. We'll see what we can do.
Is the production assistant posting available now, or?
Yes, it is. It's been advertised and it will close, I think it's March 3rd is the 3rd. Deadline for application.
Yep. Okay.
Another thing I should mention, I think this kind of fits here, is that Scott Smith and I have been talking about Life in the Park and the viewership that he receives in relation to the amount of work that's put into that show. So we are going to be going to an every other week format starting in March. So I think it works out to be March 4th, and I'm not sure, but anyway, every other week. And then he'll be using those off weeks to research some other ideas for the program, look into what other communities are doing across the country to attract viewership for those types of programs. And then we'll hope to roll out something new in June.
Do we have Any idea of how many people do watch the channels that we operate right now? We can speculate, but I don't know if there's actually a way to come up with a hard number as such.
Does Nielsen give us numbers on that?
They don't. You know, people have to pay for those Nielsen figures, and so we are not participating in that yet. But the last time a city survey was done, it's been a number of years, 9, 10 years perhaps, and we were able to ask a number of questions related to technology, and included in that was, how often do you watch local cable channels? But so that information is so old that I've forgotten it. And I did try to research that recently for a question from someone else and couldn't find the answer. But the gist of it is that there is money in our budget to do a technology survey in the next year. We kind of already have postponed that a couple times for various reasons. So we do hope to get some more questions to find out how many folks are watching the cable channel. And the numbers that Jackie specifically referred to are the number of YouTube hits, which the Life in the Park program, it plays on each of our local channels. I bet during the course of a day you might be able to watch it 8 or 10 different times. So we know that folks are watching it on cable TV because of the opportunities across the board on each of the local channels.
Great. Thank you. Any further questions? Comments? Thank you. Next item is the cable TV technology presentation, including fiber optic technology. It's been an interest of this commission to learn more about fiber optic technology. It was one of our goals for this year. And I believe that Reg has sought out a video that kind of goes through the technical aspects, not so technical aspects, but we'll familiarize ourselves with fiber optic cables and the difference between that and coax. So take it away, Reg.
So I put together a 7-hour presentation on this, so I hope you're comfortable. Actually, this is a 7-minute video which includes a couple of different topics, but it's pretty enjoyable, and raise your hand if we need to stop it at any point. But
I find this a fascinating object. It's a fiber optic cable for a stereo. If I shine this laser pointer down the cable, it guides the light out the other end. These cables are used to connect our world today and are capable of transmitting information across countries and oceans. But first, let me show you how it works. I have a bucket that I've modified with a window in front. And on the other side, I put a stopper in this hole right here. I have a bottle of propylene glycol with just a little bit of creamer in it. A ring stand. And of course, a laser pointer. Now, keep your eye on this plug when I turn out the lights. That's wonderful. The light follows the liquid flow all the way to the bucket. Amazing. It does this because of total internal reflection. As the light enters the stream, it is reflected as soon as it hits the interface between air and liquid. You can see here the first reflection, and then the second, and the third. This occurs because there's a difference between the index of refraction of the guide material, here propylene glycol, and the outside, air in this case. Recall that any time light strikes a surface, it can either be absorbed by the material, reflected from it, or pass into and through it. The latter we call refraction. It's easier to see from a top view. Reflection and refraction can happen at the same time, but if a light ray hits the surface at an angle greater than the critical angle, it will be completely reflected and not refracted. For this propylene glycol and air system, as long as a beam hits the surface at an angle greater than 44.35 degrees, measured from the normal, it will propagate down the stream via total internal reflection. To create this same effect in an optical fiber, engineers create a core of glass, usually pure silicon dioxide, and an outside layer called cladding, which they also typically make from silicon dioxide, but with bits of boron or germanium to decrease its index of refraction. A 1% difference is enough to make a fiber work. To make such a long, thin piece of glass, engineers heat a large glass preform. Its center is the pure core glass and the outside the cladding. They then draw or pull a fiber by winding the melt onto a wheel at speeds up to 1600 meters per second. Typically, these drawing towers are several stories tall. The height allows the fiber to cool before being wound onto a drum. One of the greatest engineering achievements was the first ocean-spanning fiber optic cable. Called TAT-8, it extended from Tuckerton, New Jersey, following the ocean floor over 3,500 miles until branching out to Whitmouth, England and Pont-Mâche, France. Engineers designed the cable carefully to survive on the ocean floor. At its center lies the core. Less than a tenth of an inch in diameter, it contains six optical fibers wrapped around a central steel wire. They embedded this in an elastomer to cushion the fibers, surrounded it with steel strands, and then sealed it inside a copper cylinder to protect it from water. The final cable was less than an inch in diameter, yet it could handle some 40,000 simultaneous phone calls. The essence of how they send information through a fiber optic cable is very simple. I could have a prearranged signal with someone at the other end. Perhaps we'll use Morse code, and I just block the laser so that the person at that end sees flashes that communicate a message. To transmit an analog signal, like voice from a phone call along the cable, engineers use pulse code modulation. We take an analog signal and cut it up into sections and then approximate the wave's loudness or amplitude as best we can. We want to make this a digital signal, which means discrete values of loudness and not just any value. For example, I'll use 4 bits, which means I have 16 possible values for the loudness. So the first 4 sections of the signal could be approximated by about 10, 12, 14, and 15. We then take each section and convert its amplitude to a series of ones and zeros. The first bar of value 10, when encoded, becomes 1, 0, 1, 0. We can do this for each section of the curve. Now, instead of looking at the green waveform or even the blue bars, we can think of the signal as a series of ones and zeros organized by time. And it is that sequence that we send through a fiber optic cable, a flash for a one and nothing for a zero. Of course, the exact method of encoding is known at the receiving end, so it is a trivial matter to decipher the message. Now, you may be wondering how a laser pulse can travel nearly 4,000 miles across the ocean. It doesn't without some help, because the light will escape from the sides of the fibers. Look back at our propylene stream. Here's how the light attenuates as it travels. You can see here a narrow beam in the bucket that broadens a bit when it enters the stream, and then after the first bounce, the beam leaves even broader than it entered. That's because the interface with the air is uneven, and the rays that make up the beam strike at slightly different angles. When that beam makes its second reflection, those individual rays diverge even more, until by the time it reaches the third bounce, many of the rays are no longer at the critical angle and can exit from the sides of the stream. Here it happens in a few inches, but in a cable like TAT-8, the signal travels a stunning 50 kilometers before it needs to be amplified. Absolutely amazing. I'm Bill Hammack, the Engineer Guy.
Coax and fiber optic cables. Coax typically came in two different types, thin net or 10 base 2, which is narrow gauge coax similar to household coax that have a 300 foot range. Thick net is about a half inch in diameter, 10 base 5 regular gauge coax, and has a 1500 foot range. The average bandwidth was about 10 megabits per second. Coax uses BNC connectors, T's, and so forth, similar to water plumbing. In fact, a very common method of connection was through a vampire tap, which the admin simply drilled a hole anywhere in the cable and clamped on the tap, which is also an adapter. The most common topology was bus. Coax must terminate with ground to absorb the signal to prevent it from bouncing and causing collisions. Fiber optics. Several gigabits per second is offered through fiber optics. Short runs can use plastic or glass fibers, LEDs or lasers, and wavelengths of 650 or 850 nanometers. Multi-mode uses 850 nanometers or 1300 nanometer wavelengths. Single-mode lasers use 1310 nanometers or 1500 nanometers for very long distances. Single-mode fiber is capable of going up to 100 kilometers. Multimode and hybrid are capable of going up to 2 kilometers. Fiber works by reflecting or bouncing the light along the fiber. The glass is transparent, but the inside surface is very reflective. Fiber works by reflecting or bouncing the light along the fiber. The glass is transparent, but the inside surface is very reflective. Unlike metal-based cables, fiber optic cables are much more difficult to repair or terminate and are much more fragile.
I already knew all that stuff. But
no, you didn't. Mr. Wizard.
I thought the demonstration, I was blown away by the demonstration with the stream. That was really a great visual there that, you know, I've never seen before. So that's fascinating.
Could we run that a dozen more times? No, I'm kidding.
So it's now actually my next well question is, they said that the TAT 8 had went, what, 50 kilometers before it had to be, so they have amplifiers all the way across the, and what powered that?
Good question.
Solar
so
energy.
That's the next meeting.
Anyway. So the thing I wanted to piggyback on the back of this is the Comcast cable system is called HFC for hybrid fiber coax. So they use fiber to get it around town to the different cities, and they bring fiber into your neighborhood that feeds approximately 400 to 500 homes. At least that's what it was like back in 1996 when it was first installed. I think it was 96. So it could be that they have a few more nodes now, and they service a smaller number of households than 400 or 500 homes. But then the coax cable, that's why it's important to know there's a difference between the two. That stuff that's installed inside your house is coax cable, and that's what connects from the wall jack into your cable modem or to your cable box, which, of course, everyone needs one. You can't connect that directly to a TV and see anything right now with Comcast cable because it's the way it's encrypted everywhere. And all channels are encrypted. So that's a little bit of an introduction then to fiber, and that's about as far as I can go with it. We did have a tour one time of Comcast's head end over in Roseville, and we've talked about doing that again. And another thing we've talked about, which Mr. Chair, you and I will talk about further, we can have a discussion amongst the commissioners, is whether to have a meeting at the CenturyLink head end in Golden Valley to see how their technology works, which is different. That's IP-based, and it's internet-based, and I can't exactly explain it. I remember Brian Grogan gave a pretty good demonstration. The shortest possible explanation is that all of this information that Comcast sends you is available at all times to your television tuner, whereas the CenturyLink product, you get one stream at a time. And that's why they're able to send high definition signals over a relatively small bandwidth cable that's in your household.
Fascinating. Any comments?
The fiber's getting faster. They didn't allude to that in this, but they've done in the laboratory terabit per second, petabit per second. I think I made mention on Monday night that those kinds of speeds, you could download a full season of Game of Thrones in 20 seconds to your computer. So that's in the works. I don't know how far off it is, but it's going to just accelerate faster and faster. The world of coaxial cable probably is going to go away at some point, but nobody seems to know precisely when yet. But I think that will happen at some point because it just makes sense.
Well, there's a lot of other benefits to fiber too, that outside of that, but electrical resistance, lightning, things like that. It's I've put a lot of fiber in out at the airport in the parking lot and got rid of all of our lightning problems, because before everything was connected copper and one good strike, take care all down. So, no, it's fascinating technology. The sooner it gets to our homes, I think, the sooner we'll all be happy.
I can, Kate is here from Comcast, so I can needle her for just a second. Do you have any idea? I would assume Comcast at some point is going to say, gee, let's run fiber to the premises or to the person's home. Do you have any idea how far away? I know you're going to be running the speed up considerably with a new standard coming up probably by the end of this year. Do they have any plans from a fiber connective perspective at this point, or are they going to pretty much stick with the coax for right now?
I mean, we definitely have fiber for customers, but coax is still a great product. That's still, we offer up to 250. Our speeds right now, customers can call in and be like, I would like 250. We are bringing in 2 gigabytes, 5 gigabytes. That's definitely coming over fiber. So stay posted. And I'll definitely keep Reg updated on all this stuff. We're making a lot of changes, so 2016 will be an exciting year.
Thanks.
By the end of the year, the DOCSIS 3.1 modems will be introduced on the Comcast system, and what that means, it's a new standard, and that means a lot more stuff can get through the coax pipe, in other words. That's what it really means. And so the speeds are much greater, and what's exciting for customers is that that will be a much better price point than the fiber to the home. Because right now, in some areas, Comcast would connect you with fiber all the way to your home. It's expensive, and I don't know if there are any St. Louis Park customers that are doing that. But that is available as an option, and it might be it's hundreds of dollars per month for fiber to the home.
That would be more business-related probably at that point.
Sure, and businesses that need a lot of bandwidth. So with the new cable modems, you would have a much greater speeds and for a more reasonable, more consumer kind of price than what you would get for that kind of commercial fiber to the home product.
I would think that when Menards starts selling fiber optic do-it-yourself type stuff the same way they do coax, we're much closer to it being in more places.
I can speak from experience that Menards runs a fiber network all the way through their store, and everything is connected on the store, through the yard, everything on fiber to individual switches. But it's fascinating, unbelievably fast. So, excellent. They'll probably be selling that pretty soon. go to Menards and get a fan out kit.
Are they paying you for this?
Yeah, right. Well, that's not yet. I think you still got to go to Annixter or someplace like that. Great. Thank you. Any other comments? All right. Moving on. The next item is item C, brainstorm future topics for commission action based on the discussion at the city study session on February 22nd. Our very own Bruce Browning gave a wonderful presentation during a council meeting that had 8 different commissions and groups speaking, and I thought we really knocked it out of the park with ours. So even though we did not have
even without a PowerPoint presentation.
Even without a PowerPoint, which was awesome, your comment there. Maybe that's one of the brainstorm actions, is we could have a PowerPoint presentation. No, I'm not sure. I'll open it up to the rest of the group here if anybody has any comments.
Yeah, I didn't. During that presentation, I actually pretty much just talked a lot about the CenturyLink piece, because that's what most of our time was spent on last year. One of the things that's been in the back of my mind, well, a couple of things, one of which was more promotion for Park TV in some fashion. I'm not even sure what the best way to do that is yet. Signage comes to mind because, you know, you see signage for things all over the place. Electronic signage, maybe. Something in front of City Hall would be nice. I think there are, and I know that's not an inexpensive proposition, I'm sure it's not, but maybe it could be put in with other things as well, so we could roll things for Park TV and other things that are going on in the city at the same time. So that maybe it better distributes the cost, perhaps. That was just a thought. I think Reg mentioned that in one of these things that there are places where you can put bumper stickers and things on trucks, too, which I think is a good idea. I mean, why not toot our own horn a little bit? And if that would help people understand that, yeah, we have a lot going on, and most of it's pretty good, but not everybody is always aware of that. I wasn't aware of all the commissions we had so much until Monday night. So, yeah, it doesn't hurt to promote what we're doing, and I think we could do more of that.
I think that's a great, great idea for a future topic. We could do a vinyl wrap of one of the water towers, Park TV, the one right along Highway 100,
or LED lighting, just circulating around the tower.
Any other items? Does staff have anything to add?
I notice it says brainstorm for the commission, so us as a whole. But is there anything that the council would like
to recommend
us to do or look into, or complaints that they get?
There wasn't feedback that I heard that gave any specific direction, and so I don't have anything to report there. There was a couple questions raised, and Bruce answered them beautifully. So The one thing I can suggest is we could have an update or have our CIO, Clint Pyers, come in and talk to us again and perhaps address the appropriate role for the commission in any information technology issues that they may want some feedback on. I'll give you an example. Going back a few years ago, every computer in the city here was a PC-based computer. But then iPads were invented, and suddenly the demand for iPad-type apps or technologies was just unbelievable because there were some really useful things that were on iPads. And so the city's started buying iPads and deploying them around. So right about the point where that would have become a difficult decision, that might have been a good time to involve the commission in a decision like that, for example, to hear what the pluses and minuses were of these technologies and get some citizen feedback as to what would this really pay off for our customers, for our residents, or is it just going to be an in-house thing, things like that. So I know Clint has talked a little bit to me about those kinds of decisions, and I don't know what they might be, but perhaps there'll be something appropriate for the commission to tackle in that style.
Do you think it would be I don't know, just talking aloud a little bit, do you think it would be even appropriate to be in a study session with the City Council sometime that we could set up to get some feedback from them as well as Clint, like, okay, what would you like us to do? Or maybe they don't have an answer to that at this point. The technology keeps moving. It's not sitting still, and we really can't sit still either if we're going to keep people aware of what's going on. So maybe that's a possibility as well. I don't know.
I think that if there was a technology issue that Clint brought to the City Council, that there's always the chance it could get bounced to this commission. I think that's the way we should probably proceed, is to for staff here, for me to talk to Clint about that possibility and see if there's any specific technologies or specific decisions that are coming up that they might want some additional feedback on, or if there's a big issue that's coming up for council. Maybe it's a purchasing thing. Maybe it's the scale of something we're going to buy. Should we buy it at a certain level, or should we go in all in on it because we think it's a technology that will really be useful for residents? So I think we should work through Clint on that. And it would have been nice if the council would have had some specific direction at this past Monday night meeting, and there wasn't any direction. So I don't think just scheduling something in a study session would necessarily elicit much more direction, because they had a great opportunity to do that, and there was nothing specifically on their plate right now that they needed advice on.
Did other commissions receive specific instructions from council or specific topics that they should look into on Monday night?
I think it fell more into the feedback from council on what they worked on their work plan generally.
I got the impression there was a couple of groups that would have benefited from some kind of a strategic planning process. You know, that they really were kind of in between gigs, didn't really know. And I don't know if that's a possibility. I know when we were on the school board, that always really helped us every 5 years or so to go through a fairly robust process to figure out what direction we want to go and things like that. And I don't know if the city must do that, and I don't know how that relates to technology, but, you know, maybe we could delve into that and have our own maybe abbreviated process to figure out some kind of direction.
If I can just address that, the council does have a list of strategic directions that they're taking for the next, it's actually, I think, through 2025. So there's a number of goals underneath all of those directions to support those, and one of them is to be a technology-connected community. So, of course, many of the things that our CIO is working on are related to that goal, and so anything that this commission does should certainly support that council goal. And we could bring a copy of that to the next meeting so that you can see that and see all of the activities that are taking place beneath it.
Yeah, that's exactly, yeah, the action plan and everything that goes with it, that'd be awesome. Excellent. Anything else? All right. I think we'll move on to D, Comcast HD enhancements and set-top box exchanges. Is that Reg or Kate?
You want me to go,
yes. Kate go right Hansing for it? With Comcast is here.
So yes, thanks for having me tonight. So we are introducing our MPEG-4 technology. Currently, we have MPEG-2. MPEG-4, it's expected to enter the market end of Q2, or end of May. And it frees up HD capacity, and it provides faster internet speeds because it uses bandwidth more efficiently. And so what customers need to do to get a product is channel 1995 on their TV will let them know if their box is compatible with MPEG-4. So for example, if you have the X1, you're completely fine. You would never have to go in and change your box. So if you go to each of your TVs that has a box on it, it will tell you, yep, you need to get a new box. And you can order it straight from the screen, or you can call in, or you can go to any store, and they'll, you know, hand you the box over and be like, here you go, this will work. Or, you know, if you need a tech to come out, you can, you, when you call in, they can help a tech show you how to set up a box. I work with Heather Olson very closely in your St. Louis Park store, and she's informed me that if anyone ever has any questions or when they're handing out a box, they show them how you can put it in whenever they come. And I know that the store's been very successful. They haven't had anyone come in and, you know, come back or anything like that. A lot of customers are dropping off equipment. But it's a seamless, pretty seamless process from what I've seen. We're doing it nationwide, so we're all kind of doing it at the same time. And like Reg said, this really opens our opportunity for the DOCSIS 3.1 at the end of the year to really bring this all the way around.
Is there a time frame for this that it has to be done by?
So right now the date I have is by, it would be by the end of May, end of quarter two, which would be May.
So if they don't have it done by then, what happens to their reception at that
they'll
point?
They'll lose some channels.
Okay.
They will lose channels. So how we're doing it is we will do it in little pieces. So we'll do just a few channels at the beginning, in case, kind of like how we did encryption, you know, and we warn customers like, hey, this is happening. And then all of a sudden there was one date where it all changed. But so we'll do it in four stages throughout the month of May. So, you know, once customers see channels kind of moving, but then the last cut will be at the majority of channels. And I told Reg earlier tonight, it's a handful of customers. I can't give you a specific number for the Twin Cities because I work in Wisconsin, Missouri, Kansas, and Minnesota, so I have the full number. But I can, even with the full number, it really is, you know, a handful of customers. And we will be sending out three notifications plus a couple of letters prior to customer notifications coming out. So they'll get about five pieces of mail. And once they have the equipment, the letters go away and the scroll on the screen will go away. So they're aware that if you have the proper equipment, you won't see anything pop up on your TV.
How soon, Kate, can they actually start doing this?
They can, they're already, right it's now? Already happening. Yeah. Okay. I've seen, I see the numbers, and just with we had what's called a mirror nation letter, like, hey, this is happening. We're just giving you a heads up. You know, you don't have to do anything right now, but pretty soon you will need to. I mean, the number has dramatically decreased on the number of customers that are getting the equipment. So it's good to see that, because we definitely, you know, the last thing we want are customers turning on a channel and then it not happening. But we're sending emails out to customers who, you know, don't do paper, they pay online. So we're making sure that everyone is aware of us making this change.
So how old are those boxes that you're replacing?
You know, there's so many different boxes, and there's so many, like, I wish I had the list in front of me. You'd be surprised. There are, you know, 20 boxes that are completely fine. You're completely fine keeping them on your TV. And then there could be 20 boxes that are called legacy boxes, and those could be 10 plus years old. But they work, but now we're changing our technology so they won't work anymore. So that's why we need to get everyone with the most updated boxes.
And you have to change the box instead of pushing out a new firmware update?
right.
to those boxes? Mm-hmm. Because why? How exactly is it running more efficiently?
So it's all based on the technology. So these legacy boxes just can't handle the new technology that we're introducing.
The hardware is different.
Yeah, exactly.
So there's disk that spin. Is it solid state? I mean, RAM?
I honestly
you don't know.
I would expect the decoding process is a lot different because you're talking about the X1 box now
right.
as the replacement, and the hardware for that would be a lot different for MPEG-4 than
exactly.
it would have been for any of the earlier MPEG series things. So that has to do with decoding and chipsets in the box and hardware.
Yeah, and I will say this is a great opportunity for customers to get the X1. It is a really great product.
True, but it's a lot more expensive. I mean, that's kind of, it's a hassle to come in and swap out your box and,
I understand
more.
That, but it is a
drop cable too.
Yeah, that's always an opportunity as well.
For clarification's sake, do they have to go to the X1 box?
No. Mm-mm.
Okay, so that's a choice that they still have.
Exactly.
If they want to get the service that you're describing, then they need to update the set-top box to get that to happen.
Yep.
But they could still use their earlier version boxes, but they may find themselves a little crippled in terms of what they can receive?
No, so if you go in with your box like, hey, I got this letter from Comcast, I know that you're going through this, they just give you the correct box. There's no price change. There's
okay.
nothing like, yeah.
Okay.
Yep.
So the X1 would be actually kind of a step up further.
Yep, because you would pay that that fee on the X1 box.
Okay.
Yep. But
so they don't have to go to the X1
absolutely
box.
Absolutely not.
They don't have to pay extra to do that. They will still get something that works even if it's not the X1
oh,
box.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Okay.
Yep.
That 100%. Helps.
I remember when we toured the Roseville Head End, they had that one aspect, that one part of the place where they tested all the different technologies that they supported through all the communities. And I remember sitting there thinking, wow, they need to consolidate this down to like a
right.
couple. And I'm sure that's what this effort is doing. I mean, they had the Scientific Atlanta. They had, you know, just all the legacy things that they've
yeah,
inherited from, a lot of places. So, well, that's a great effort. So,
and that's why I recommend if you guys do want to do a head-end tour, you can see how much it's changed. I just went with another cable commission about a month ago and just how much it's expanded in that office and how much fiber and what they're doing and how they're trying to get ahead of issues before customers even call in to say, hey, we have an issue. So yeah, if you ever have time, I would love to go on that tour with you.
Kate, customers that use DTA boxes instead of the larger ones, are they affected at all by the switchover?
It would depend on the type of DTA. I know there are legacy DTA boxes that we have, but when we just went through that B1 encryption, I believe those customers should be fine. The most recent change that we went through last year was, or 2 years ago. Yeah, they should, because those were boxes that we brought out. But a customer will know if they need to change anything if the scroll appears on their TV. And that's how they'll know. There might be, maybe their main TV is completely fine, but they might have a box on a kitchen TV that's not right, or in a bedroom or a basement. And then that's how they'll know that TV needs to swap out the box.
So by the end of June, will there be a mix of MPEG-4 and MPEG-2 encoded channels? MPEG-2 is not going away entirely, is it? Or is it being entirely replaced by MPEG-4?
So it'll be MPEG-4. It will change to MPEG-4, which is why everyone needs the new. Because if they didn't change it, then they would lose channels.
They would lose channels, or they would lose all their channels?
They would lose all of the channels.
Okay, so by the end of June, if they haven't changed out their box, they won't have any channels to tune in then.
It'll show a blank screen. That's correct.
Okay. So they better watch everything on their DVR before the end of June.
I will also say that the good thing about MPEG-4 is it doubles your DVR storage, which right now I don't have that problem, but come Game of Thrones time, I will begin to have that problem. But that's a nice added benefit to it.
Go ahead.
What's the current then storage for DVR?
They're all different. I'll have to check. I have the X1,
okay.
So I know that, but I'd have to look. I'm sorry.
Ballpark.
No, I honestly don't have.
Gigs? No.
I really don't have a guess, but I can get that to Reg.
the X1 approximately 100 hours of HD material, and it's hard to say because exactly I don't know the number of gig of the hard drive. But another little bit more background on MPEG-2 has been an encoding standard for maybe 15 years, and MPEG-4 has been introduced for roughly 6 to 8 years, and so the industry has behind the scenes been doing this all along. And what's happening right now is you're getting a mix of channels at your house. Some of them are, most of them are in MPEG-4, some of them are still in MPEG-2, and those are the ones that you would no longer see. Mm-hmm. At the point where they all get switched to MPEG-4, you have an encoder that can pick up the mix of channels, but it wouldn't be able to pick up only the MPEG-4 channels. So that's why the boxes have to be switched. It's, as Bruce said, it's the hardware inside the box itself.
I think the other thing too is I believe MPEG-4 is actually better quality.
It is, yeah.
Not to bring up your competitor DirecTV, but they've been doing MPEG-4 for quite a while, mm-hmm. and that's one of the reasons they find that the dynamic range of what you're watching looks a lot better in MPEG-4 than it ever did on MPEG-2. So 15 years is a long time in technology, so this is a far better approach.
Yeah. Do you want me to talk about other Comcast stuff, or just...
Oh. I can think of one, because you and I talked about this before we started. You're going to revise your bills.
Yes, we are.
Which is a good thing.
So Bruce and I were talking earlier, you know, probably the biggest complaint we get is the billing. It's sometimes bills can be very hard to understand. And so we have done a pilot program out on the West Coast, completely have changed our bills. You know, made them a lot easier to read. And I will say our call volume has gone down dramatically. And so we have made a change. We're going to make that change nationwide. I'm currently working on the Twin Cities. I don't have a specific date. It takes a lot of time to make sure you got to follow state laws and make sure you have all the right stuff in there. But we will be changing our bills, and customers will be able to really understand what they're paying for. So that's a nice change to it.
I think
part of our customer experience change that we're going through.
I'm jumping the gun here a little bit because we haven't really gotten into complaint logs, but so much of what I saw in the complaint logs from this last time around, a lot had to do with billing.
Mm-hmm.
And people just don't, they get a special, and Kate and I were talking about this, they get a special for a year. And at the end of that special, suddenly their cost goes up and they can't figure out, well, my bill was this, and now all of a sudden it's this. What changed? And they're all upset with Comcast.
Mm-hmm.
And understandably, Comcast really didn't say, oh, by the way, you're reaching the end of that deal that we gave you for 1 year, and your bill is going to go up as a result of that. And I mentioned to Kate, if there was a way that they could do something on the billing for these people that have gotten these special deals, quote unquote, to let them know that this is not running forever, if they could let them know on a bill that says, hey, this is coming up and your cost is going to change, if you want to discuss that or something, please give one of our representatives a call. Maybe that would be helpful. Because people just forget. Heck, I do too from time to time. But yeah, you're used to paying X amount of money, and then all of a sudden the year starts, and if it isn't just a regular increase, but it's a much larger one, and you wonder what the heck happened. Well, that's because the deal went away suddenly.
Mm-hmm.
And there's always deals out there, I know. Mm-hmm. You just have to talk to somebody most of the time. So I think that would be a good thing if there's a way to do it.
Yeah, absolutely. The other thing that we are that we're bringing in the Twin Cities, you know, one of the biggest complaints is call centers. And so we currently have a call center in Minnetonka, and we have a call center in St. Paul, in our office in St. Paul, and we are bringing 400 people in to open another call center in St. Paul, and that will be happening end of quarter one. We're in the process of just finishing all of the hirings and having them go through their proper trainings and all of our customer experience, things that we're going through. We've invested $300 million into it to really make sure we're changing. We definitely know this is a problem that we have. And so I'm excited that the Twin Cities was picked as another local call center. So that'll be a really nice change. And then before I forget, Comcast Cares Day is April 30th, and St. Louis Park got picked again this year for a Comcast Cares Day site. at Perspectives Inc. And so I will give you all of that information. Kind of, I know last year the mayor and Councilmember Mavity came out and helped us do a bunch of the projects, and that was awesome. And it was a lot of fun. We had a lot of volunteers. And so I'll make sure to give Reg all of the information. And if any of you guys ever want to come out, it's a really fun day.
What day is that?
April 30th.
Okay.
It's usually from about 8 a.m. to noon is when we do painting and mulching and just whatever they need us to do, we do that.
My company does the same thing just down the street at the step.
Oh, so. Nice.
Awesome.
Kate, is there any projected date that the customers will see a change in the design of their bill? Will that be happening before the end of the year?
Yes. Mm-hmm. So I can say that, but I don't have a specific date or a specific month. It's kind of, there's a team of us just making sure, like I said, you have to follow a lot of protocols with the state on what's on a bill. Each state's different. So we just want to make sure that we have all of that approved. And then it will change. Then once Carly and I have been able to go through it and work with the lawyers, then you'll see a change. But it will happen this year.
Anything else? Thank you very much, Kate. Wonderful. On to complaint logs. There was a number of them. I think we touched on it. It seemed to be a lot of billing questions, which we just talked about, deals running out, things like that. And I don't know, were there any that stood out to
There was one from a former commissioner once upon a time here, and I don't know if we got it resolved or not, Reg, I'm not sure if you know, but he was having a problem with the X1 box. It seems like he has to reset it every week to 10 days, he said, and it'll work fine for a while, and then all of a sudden it will drop out again and he'll have to go through the same process, which makes me wonder, as we were talking about a little earlier, whether there may be a connection problem to his facility. And it may not be the box, but it may be the strength of the signal coming into the box. I don't know, and Reg, I don't know if that's been resolved or not. I'm not sure.
Not that I know of, and I know he's had more than one box before and swapped out. And John happened to mention how, when you've got a DVR, it's kind of a drag to have to swap the box out when you've got recorded material on there that you wanted to watch. But on the other hand, if you're having a technical problem that just can't be fixed, that's pretty much no way to fix it other than swapping the box, then you have to go that route. But I think you're right. It's always possible that it could be the signal level which is causing problems with the system, so it's just not operating correctly.
Were they able to escalate that at all at this point, or do you know?
I don't know. I think he just said that's been his practical workaround. Would be if you reboot it yourself occasionally, then it doesn't have to reboot itself so much at an inconvenient time.
Mm-hmm. It doesn't. I don't know. Maybe there's something we can do about that after the meeting tonight or something. But yeah, a lot of the complaints had to do with billing. I was curious, Reg, and I don't know if you have the answer. Does CenturyLink have an escalation team for bills or problems?
We send them to Kirsten Sersland, one of the spokespersons
okay.
For CenturyLink, and then also copy to an administrative person. So far with the small number of complaints we've had, the reaction's been good, but I don't have enough of a track record with them to know.
Okay.
But as an example, whenever I send an email on the behalf of a customer to Comcast, I tell them to expect a call within 24 hours, and that almost always happens, which is a pretty good response for an escalated problem.
Yeah, there were maybe one or two complaints that had to do with CenturyLink proper. I don't know whether they were resolved or not because it really doesn't say. So I was just curious.
There was one that was kind of alarming to me, and it was about the husband's lifeline not working. And I don't see if that's been resolved. Typically, those lifelines I thought were on a copper line. They're always supposed to work.
So it does show that you can convert them to the Comcast technology, and the in their telephone system, and that customer was handled that day, and the message was sent to me, and I forwarded a voice message to the Comcast escalation team. But then the customer hadn't heard back yet and was very concerned about the lifeline, and so they went to the cable store in Excelsior Boulevard. This is one of those times when it's really nice to have a cable store where you can talk to a person, and they were able to get somebody out that day to get that working. So that that happened after I sent the packet to you, so that was very good to hear, because I did speak to that person in the middle of the afternoon or so, and a technician was on the way.
Good, thank you.
Anything else? All right, moving on. Communications from the chair, commissioner, and city staff. I have none. Anything from any of the other commissioners? City staff?
I have one more thing, and I would like to just acknowledge that Amy has been our terrific recording secretary for 12 years, she told me before the meeting, and Amy is moving on to other things, and so just a big thank you for doing those moments. You've saved me hours of work over the last 12 years.
Wow, I think she's been here as long as I have. I mean, I think I went to one meeting, and then you were like at the next one. So, because you have the same last name, right, Peterson? So that's how I remember. So, yeah. Ah, well, thank you for your service. And
in the future.
Yeah. You can still come. Well, thank you. With that, I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
I'll move that we adjourn.
All right. Do you vote on those here?
You don't have to.
Oh, okay. Well, in that case, we have a motion, and we will stand adjourned.